All right. Hello there, ladies, gentlemen,
gamers,
and TikTok lovers, enjoyers, and enthusiasts. It is currently 1 a.m. in my household, and I've procrastinated all day. But no more procrastinating. Now, we're finally going to do a TikTok reaction. So, I usually do these every Friday. However, today is Thursday. Well, technically it's Friday morning. So I usually do these Saturday morning. However, I am taking this Friday off for a mental health day to go to the therapist. So I thought, what better way to spend the night slash morning than to react to TikToks, which we do anyway tomorrow. And I might do it tomorrow too, just to catch up, but we'll see. But anyway, I thought to do it tonight. So we're going to pick up right where we left off last time. Last time we had some existential crises. We had that again today, but we need a new unique title. So this unique title is going to be Debt Ceiling Looms. Now, I don't know if we're going to get to the video. So as I always say, much like my job and in life, I'm very behind on my TikToks. So I keep sending myself more that show us what a dark dimension we live in. And the more I send, the less I get to each episode because I talk over them for a while. But we're going to try and lessen the load now. So we're going to be pretty behind, even more behind than usual, but hopefully we can get to it. So without further ado, let us begin. It's not only going to be debt ceiling, obviously.
Debt, and we want to know how to get debt free without filing bankruptcy.
So the beginning got cut off there for a little bit, but essentially this couple... Just replay the beginning. They have a 1 million staggering amount of debt. Now, I'm not going to play the whole video here for brevity's sake, but essentially, I wanted to show this video. I sent this video to myself because it's just going to show that there's people out there where if you have no debt, you are vastly, vastly in a better spot than a majority of the population. Now, from a lot of the videos that, you know, we've seen and are going to see, we're going to see, and we've seen, that I believe 60% of Americans only have like $1,000 in their bank account left. You know, just if anything happens. And most Americans are actually carrying debt. And, you know, now that's especially true with the economy going to shit and us defaulting almost. So, living without debt, you know, is good. Or having not that much debt, ironically enough, nowadays is also pretty good because now it's almost seen, the culture in America has basically become like, you're expected to carry debt. The two biggest debts you're expected to carry within your lifetime, number one is student loans, and number two is a mortgage. Those are the two debts that you are going to probably spend a majority of your life paying off if you're an average person, at least in America. Now, excuse me, whew. Aside from those debts, now just to live day to day to even afford food like we've seen before in previous videos, you need to open a line of credit. You need to do buy now, pay later for groceries. So now people just being able to live, not even buy houses, not even just, you know, have a roof over their heads or even learn, just to be able to eat, people need to go into debt, which is scary. I don't know what this family's doing. They have $1 million in debt, but yeah, this is more common than you think. And, you know, at this point, we're not going to, okay, if you don't have debt, just if you don't have a lot. This family has $1 million. They have a lot. Don't be like them. But if you have, like, a little bit amount of debt, I mean, any debt is bad, but again, you want to minimize it, right? So we're basically becoming a American culture of, you know, you're going to have debt, just don't have that much, which is sad. The fact that reality has got to this point, we're in the dark dimension. But let's hear what this family has to say. How did they get into this? Let's see if I was correct, because like I said, I actually don't remember this one. I sent it to myself so long ago. In fact, you know, on 4/11, this thing came out, so May's almost done. So, you know, this is a little old.
I have probably just under $1 million in debt.
Jesus Christ.
And we want to know how to get debt-free without filing bankruptcy.
Pray to God.
Okay, how much of that is a mortgage?
I love Dave Ramsey's face here, so... Let's see if I'm accurate in saying it's the mortgage and it's student loans.
Mortgage.
That's the biggest ones.
The mortgage, about 210.
So 210 doesn't sound that bad. But you got to remember, $210,000 for a mortgage, I believe that's how much they lent them. I don't think that's what they're paying in interest.
So you have $600,000 in what?
In what?
335 is about in student loans.
And there it is. And there it is. It sounds like the two biggest ones, well, not maybe not even, but two big ones are student loans and mortgage. I'm surprised the student loans are bigger than the mortgage, honestly.
We both have advanced degrees, and then a lot, the rest is really credit cards and personal loans.
So you have $300,000 of credit cards and personal loans?
We have about so 335,000 student loans and about 136,000 in credit cards, 44,000 personal loans, and 35,000 car loans.
Okay.
Now, I want to
How
get to the
old are you?
important part of how old they are and
I'm
how much they make.
29.
Okay. So what in the world?
So, yeah,
I
so
mean,
we,
are you both on this, or is this just one of you that's completely lost your mind?
well, I have the majority of the student loans in hand.
So I just want to put something out here, and this is going to sound mean, and it probably is, but this lady does not sound smart. She does not, like, just from her voice, right? I know that's a bad way to gauge it, but you could tell by how someone speaks, by the way they carry themselves, by the vocabulary they use. Sometimes what kind of decisions they make. This lady does not sound like she makes good decisions. I mean, again, look at her finances, right? But this is already, like, already this sounds like a recipe for disaster. And these are the people, you know, barring the student loans, right? Barring the student loans, barring the mortgage, they still have like what, 300K or around there in like personal loans? Huh? And the worst part about this is these loans have massive, massive interest rates. Why? Because you're making someone else rich. Like, bro, I don't get it. The banks in America, the best rate they'll give you if you close away your money and you pinky promise them, hey, I won't touch it. It's yours. You can make more money off of it than I will, and you'll give me some scraps. You'll make about 5% about now, and near 5%. These credit card companies charge you like 21% interest. If you want to get rich, just become a credit card company. Like, holy shit.
As the majority of the credit cards, my credit card debt is about, it's not great. It's
Okay, so
about
why
11,000.
is he at 29 years old run up 100 grand in credit card debt?
Well, he's
Bruh.
32, but
Dave Ramsey's like, that's even worse. That doesn't matter. The older you are, the less debt you should have.
think it's one of those things where just making really poor financial decisions, thinking be able to pay it down as you go, and then it doesn't happen.
Yeah.
And
Okay. So you both have advanced degrees. What are your degrees in?
we do. So I have a degree in both of our advanced degrees. No, he has an MBA, and I have an advanced degree in policy. I work in the government, and we actually both do now at this point, actually.
Oh, what a surprise. What a surprise. The people who don't know how to manage money work for our government. Doesn't that kind of remind you of something? Furthermore, proving dark dimension.
Okay, so your household income is what?
Our household income is about 230.
Okay.
Bro, they're making $230,000 a year. They're not smart, even though they have advanced degrees. I don't get it. I don't get because they could be smart. Okay, let me get specific here before I get like flamed and canceled by my thousands and thousands of fans online. Would never do that because they love me. So, 230,000, right? How the fuck do you go into debt? Okay, let me clear some things up. I'm not saying they're stupid overall. I think intelligence is a very complicated thing. I think you could be smart at some things like I am with video games and stupid with a lot of other things like I am at life. So, I think these people might be really smart in the fields they've done, but God, they are stupid with money. But this just goes to show you, right? People who make $230,000 a year don't know how to spend it. I'll tell you this, and I think I would like speak very confidently on this, which I don't do much. If I was making $230,000 a year, or just half of that, $110,000 a year. Sorry, that's not half. Fuck. I can't do math right now. I've only slept for 3 hours. But if I was making like a little bit above 100K a year, I could probably retire within 10 years of just working, if not less, with like what I know what to do and like how to save money. Now, obviously, they're probably living way beyond their standards. You know, their mortgage, I don't think I'd get a mortgage. I'd get someplace super fucking cheap if I could. And I wouldn't spend extravagantly to have 100K or more in credit card debt. Like, credit card debt is the worst that you could get. Obviously, mortgages are sort of, you know, you need them. Student loans is, you know, you need them. But credit card debt is one thing you can avoid unless you're literally starving, which at that point, you know, buy now, pay as you go with the groceries. But groceries shouldn't rack you up 100K. Like, this is just a pure example of like the average American and their stupidity with money. It's actually crazy. Anyway, we're not gonna watch the whole video. Let's go next because we're on a budget of time.
When these police officers mistook my identity and
Okay, I don't remember why I send myself this, but this just adds on to another problem, or this shows light on another problem in the, at least the states, probably in other places too. But you know, the prison system, let alone, you know, the prison system, the police system is really fucking bad. I don't think I showed the video, or if I did, it was way long ago in like a very previous episode. But there was a female officer, and I think it was in California or it was in the West Coast, who she's a senior officer. She goes to the training for new officers. She sees how it is. She speaks out against it. She says like, "Oh, this training is really bad. It makes them confrontational, and it's gonna lead to more like, you know, violence, and it's gonna lead to basically accidents in the line of work for a police officer. It's gonna be more dangerous for everyone, for the officer, for, you know, the civilians, for the victims, for the perpetrators. It's just gonna be really bad the way they're training these new people." And she was right. And what did she get for it? She got fired. Why? Because we live in the dark dimension. So let's see what the police are doing here. Now it says warning violent content. From what I can scrape from my brain long ago when I watched this, I don't think it's too violent. I don't think there's anything crazy here, but let's watch it and find out. But viewer warning for sure.
And assaulted me. They did not have my rights in mind. Because instead of
I like how they didn't have his rights in his mind, and it's like some fat ass cop above him.
admitting that they were wrong, they charged me with three felonies.
911.
Oh, I remember now. I actually, this jogged my memory of like why I sent this to me. This is disgusting.
Emergency.
Oh my God, they're pounding him in the head. They're gonna kill this man.
So this right here, for those of you who don't understand, is a 911 call they're making. You know, these random bystanders are calling the police to report that the other police are beating this guy senseless.
Yeah, I'd gotten out of work early, walking on the sidewalk on a sunny summer day, going to my internship.
Like, this guy just recounting the story sounds scared, by the way. This guy sounds like he's reliving the experience as he's telling it to us. Like, he sounds frightened. He might look around for cops right
I was
now.
calling my sister at the time and somewhat distracted by looking at my phone when two men approached me, stepped toward me off the curb and said, "You know, hey, who are you?" I said, "I'm James." And they asked me, "Is that your real name?" I said, "Yes, that's my real name."
Is that your real name? Why the fuck would you ask someone that? If they give you a name, why would you ask them, is that your real name? Already, that should be a flag for concern. Like, why would someone give you a fake name? Obviously, if you assume they're a villain or a criminal, sure, but you can't go around assuming that.
Real name. But one of them stepped behind.
Oh my God, Alan removed King's wallet? I'm Alan. But I did not remove this guy's wallet.
Behind me, boxed me out and took my wallet out of my back pocket.
So this is highly illegal what they're doing.
So I went to run, to flee, and I was tackled and ultimately beaten pretty severely. I
Senselessly.
was
Dude, look at
screaming
what's
for someone to
happening
call the
here.
police.
Oh my God. They're beating him up. Like, they're literally assaulting him.
When I was being
Also, he doesn't have a shirt.
choked, I feared for my life truly, and it was a moment where
Oh,
everything
this
went
is
black. And
sad. Damn, he looks a lot younger here too. Holy shit.
as far as I know, that is as close as you can get to being dead without being dead. The police
Wow.
came, and then that was when I realized that they weren't. muggers, but they were just police detective and an FBI agent.
In this
case, think about it, that's like higher tier police, right? Like when you think of the police, you think of the people in blue, at least here in New York. So you have an FBI and a detective, right? That's higher than the police. They beat the fuck out of this guy.
In case the officers were looking for a fugitive with an extremely broad description. James looked absolutely nothing like the photograph the officers had of the...
Bruh, how do you mistake that? Just look at that. How do you mistake that?
...fugitive whom they were looking for.
Like, what?
Do you have any weapons on you at all?
No, sir, I thought they were trying to mug me.
I remember being loaded into the back of the ambulance.
Like, the police guys ask him, like, why did they do this to you, right? The police guy's probably confused, because if you're a police officer, you're obviously, and I know police officer, you know, the whole talking about the police is already a touchy subject, because a lot of people don't want them, a lot of people do. It's a very divisive subject, and I don't plan on getting into it too much in here, but, bro, the police guy's probably wondering, why did they do this to you? Because he obviously doesn't want to go against the FBI fucking detective agent. Like, who the fuck is going to go against him, right? If you're just a regular officer, unless you got some real cojones on you. He's probably like, okay, he must have had a weapon. And this guy's like, he already sounds like he's scared. She's like, no, sir, I had nothing.
That's just being so stricken by what at all had just happened. I was in a great deal of pain when I got to the hospital.
Oh,
and I remember everyone there, the staff, the nurse, even the officer that was in charge of watching me. As I was cuffed to my bed, I remember him loosening the cuffs and telling me that I shouldn't be there.
Like, bro, I went directly even from the guy's saying it, the police is saying
hospital
it.
To the jail cell.
Bruh.
Where I was, you know, stripped of my clothing, given a jumpsuit,
get naked.
Given a mugshot, spent the night on a cold jail cell crying. I called my parents and made it there as soon as they could to bail me out.
Hello, this is a prepaid collect call from
James,
an inmate.
James, he just sounds dead. Facility.
Hello. Hey.
Hello.
We're getting screwed. I'm going to prison today. No, I don't think that. We're going to get a bondsman and get you out of there.
A bondsman.
I know. This is bad. This is really bad.
After I
so
was
it doesn't sound like they could pay that $50,000 now. Obviously, this guy's white, and obviously, this guy's a good look. So maybe he's a little bit more affluent now that time has passed, but it sounds like back then they didn't have the $50,000.
Released from jail, much to my surprise, the police officers charged me with 3 violent felonies.
Bro.
And I had to go to trial 6 months later. When the...
So, obviously, I'm not going to get the second part here, but I put this forward to just so show, like, you know... This is the sad part, too, because, you know, I'm kind of doing this in a way. I'm kind of doing, like, what I'm going to accuse, like, right now the media of. And the media, what they do is they only show you the bad. Now, I'm only showing you the bad as well, but I also want to, like, cut, you know, I want to cut to the chase. I want to keep things honest here. There are good cops out there. I've dealt with police. A lot of people have dealt with police. I've dealt with rude cops. I've dealt with bad cops. Nothing too crazy, thankfully, right? Thankfully. But I've also dealt with very good courteous cops. Now, it just takes one bad apple to ruin the bunch. And in media, all the bad stuff is the stuff that gets attention. So, you know, even though I'm showing this, I think everyone knows there's police brutality. Now, it's one thing to see it against a white man, right? That's a little bit more rare. I'm not going to go into race too much because, like I said, even with the police topic, the race topic is even more divisive one. But, yeah, just to see it happening to a white man, like, just think about it, right? I don't like to, like, you know, point out race here or anything, but just imagine, you're just a random person walking, minding your business. These guys come up to you, hey, who are you? Oh, you know, I'm Chris. Are you sure? Is that real? Yeah. And they run up to me, grab my wallet. Now, see, at that point, if that was me, I would fight for my wallet, which might be worse. Then they actually could charge me with aggravated assault. But this guy ran. He thought he was getting mugged, so his decision was thrown. And honestly, this might have saved him in the long run. Because if he stayed and fought them, you know, he probably would have gotten fucked. So he ran. They run after him, tackle him, beat the shit out of him, and he's done nothing wrong. He's probably wondering, like, okay, I'm getting gangbanged by some muggers. But no, this is the fucking people we trust to protect us. Huh? What? It's just fucking crazy. It's honestly just fucking crazy. But yeah, it could happen to anyone and everyone. obviously more often to certain people. But yeah, no, it's just sad that like stuff like this happens. And I think going back to the story I said in the beginning, it all has to do with their training. Now, obviously, no matter how much training you give some people, it's not going to matter. But training helps mitigate these things to as little as possible. You can't get rid of it, but you could definitely prevent it more. But it doesn't look like it's going to go that way because the training is bad and we're in the dark dimension. It's because we're in the dark dimension. So let's keep going to the next video.
Too many people have jobs. I'm sorry, you said too many.
Oh, this is a good one.
236,000.
So I love these type of videos here where it's like, they show what's really going on in layman's terms, in a very simple to digest way, and just how stupid it sounds and how asinine it is to a common person. Now, obviously you could get some like big wig fucking like intelligent man who's like an economist saying, well, actually, according to the economic trends, there needs to be jobs lost because of this, this, and that, and you know, this curve and this historic thing. No, if you say this to a random person who's a regular person, they're gonna be like, what the fuck is this? This is one of those videos.
1,000 jobs in
March. Also, she's very cute.
That's great. No, people have jobs. That means this is a good economy.
Yeah, no. Yeah. No.
All the economists in the news are saying it's bad. I get that you're saying it. I don't get why. It means that inflation will stay high. How? If people.
So this is the problem, right? This is where, in this dark dimension, things just don't make sense. Okay, more people have jobs. More people are working. That's good. No, 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 not in our economy. That's bad. In what, like, think about this. In the workplace, if you tell your boss, like, if your boss comes to you and says, hey, you're doing too much work, you're being too profitable for our company, stop it. You're gonna look at them like, what the hell is wrong with them? And first of all, they would never say that. Like, you'd look at them like, what are you saying? More people are working, more people are producing things. So how is inflation getting higher? Well, we've gone over that before, and hopefully she'll go over it too before I make an ass of myself. Let's see.
People have jobs, right? Then they have money. That's yes. Good.
No.
No. Then they buy stuff.
You know why that's not good? Because the rich people want more money.
With that money. That is also good for the economy. It means demand will be high and corporations will raise prices. What? Yep, supply and demand. But if more people are working, they're also producing more. So yes. Supply goes up as well. Well, yes.
Yes, but it's not equal.
If more jobs are available, workers can more easily leave their current one for a new one. So there's more competition.
And there's more economic mobility.
For labor, workers can negotiate for better pay and
economic mobility.
Benefits. It's not bad for the workers. Now they get more of a cut of the revenue they help generate. It's a bad economy.
No, see, it's perfect what they just said here. It's a bad economy. Why? Because the worker gets more of the revenue the company generates.
For who? It's bad for the shareholders. And we're still letting them raise interest rates to make people unemployed? Higher interest rates means less people will take out loans to start businesses and invest in businesses. Which means less jobs. And now it's harder to start a small business. And they're telling.
Oh, lovely. So who's going to benefit from not starting a small business? The big businesses, which don't even, like, they're going to crush the competition anyway. Like, imagine nowadays, right? We're really getting into a dystopian future here where imagine nowadays, you know, little old me, Chris Allen, wants to start his little mom and pop bakery shop, right? Chris Allen's baked cock goods. And I want to make cock-shaped bread, right? Now, while it might be funny, while it might be a little niche, I don't think other people are making cock-shaped bread out there. How the fuck am I going to compete with Amazon, which has like, you know, I'm pretty sure pretty soon they're going to have like fucking doctor's offices in their fucking like stores or whatever, right? Well, they don't even have stores yet, but let's just say Walmart. I'm pretty sure Walmart's going to start having doctors in their freaking stores. They're going to start having fitness centers in their stores. You're going to basically be able to live in Walmart. I wouldn't be surprised if they offer a hotel in Walmart eventually. Who knows, right? But Walmart basically has everything, including baked goods. Now, they might not have cocked baked goods. At the end of the day, they have baked goods that are cheaper than my ass can produce. And why? Because they have so much money. So, at the end of the day, why the fuck would a small business owner ever want to compete against big business? You're fighting a losing battle where you're just pointing the gun in your face anyway.
Telling people this is going to fix inflation, it's going to bring prices down? Yes, but they know it's not. Watch this.
Well, the Fed's interest rate increases bring food prices down for families.
I wouldn't say so, no. Well,
no. It's going to make it more expensive.
Will gas prices go down as a result of your interest rate increase?
I would not think so, no.
I would not think so. Fucking Jerome Powell, bruh.
Where has the money been going for all of the price increases?
Rich people.
53% was profit. Well, this is really cute, isn't it? We're going to pursue some policies that get us and all of our friends who own companies and have money invested in companies.
Inside trading.
You're going to get richer at the expense of every worker in America.
Inside trading.
You all should be fired. You think the people in power will fire us for doing what they want us to do? Well, you should lose re-election. We never ran for office. How long has this been going on?
Forever.
I reckon too long.
Yep, I reckon too, girl. So basically, I know I'm jumping the gun a little bit here because we're not going to get to it this episode, and I'm definitely skipping ahead probably a couple episodes, but currently what's happening with the debt ceiling is, the Republicans are basically saying, like, okay, we can't get to an agreement, let's take a break. When time is running out, like, they're at basically the final hour, and they're saying, okay, we can't agree, let's take a break, let's go home to our families, it's Memorial Day weekend, let's have some, like, relaxing time, right? And then, oh, if you Democrats want to make a deal, we'll come back, and we'll do the process, right? When basically we are out of time. Now, what does this show to me, and, how does this relate to the video here? It shows that rich people do not care about the rest of us. The rich people, and, to take it back to my example, the Republicans are willing to let the American economy and the world economy burn in shambles for the 90% of us that it really affects, because it doesn't affect them because they don't care. And it's sad. But, and we're not going to get to this, this episode, but I've included some videos later on potential solutions to this issue that I've also touched upon, but didn't go in depth on. So let's keep going. Oh, this is a good one. All right. Look, El Salvador, right? They reduced their murder rate. Wow. Oh, that's good. How the fuck did they do that? I bet you the United States cares about that because we have high crime rates. Now, when you have a high crime rate, right, you might think, like, oh, there must be a lot of criminal activity. And there is. And there is. However, you also have to, like, ask the question, why are people getting arrested? What is the law? Right? Because if the laws don't jaywalk and you get arrested for jaywalking, a lot more people is going to get arrested and the crime rate is going to go very high up. Artificially, of course. Everyone jaywalks. I just put anyone who kind of looks like a criminal in prison. You can't just do that. Why are there so many criminals in El Salvador? Because a civil war destroyed your country and 80,000 people died. Oh, nice. We made you do that. And it all goes back to the United States. So, obviously, a lot of us think the United States, and when I say us, I mean the Americans, especially down south, they love the United States. They think, like, oh, we're the best in the world. And, they've definitely been programmed to think that as growing up. But, the U.S. is very bad. I mean, all superpowers are very bad. I've said this before. In the dark dimension, almost everyone is bad. Not even just, like, the big people, even the small people, even the individuals, like all the wealthy business owners. They're pretty bad too. And then that makes the poor people bad because the poor people need to be bad just to survive. They need to steal and, pillage each other just to survive. So the poor are bad because they're forced to. The rich are bad because they want to. And the countries are bad because they're filled with bad people anyway, because we're in the dark dimension. So anyway, this is pretty fucking scary because I think I showed this on a video before where El Salvador is literally just jailing people. Like, okay, we just jail you for almost any little offense, right? And that's really scary because the prison system messes people up. And overall, unless you're like in Europe, where I forgot where it was either in like Norway or Sweden or some bullshit like over there. But one of the Europe prison systems, they actually treat their prisoners like humans. They rehabilitate them. And, ironically enough, some of these prisoners live better than regular people. They get a job. They get guaranteed housing, not in a prison cell, in an actual apartment. And they get resources to help them, and they're treated like humans, and they actually get rehabilitated way better than any other country. Now, obviously, it's not a mass-scale thing. It's definitely like a test pilot program thing, last I heard of it. But in general, that's not how the rest of the world views prisons, and this is also the same stigma in New York with homeless people. Yo, set them and forget them. They're not our problem. Let them take care of themselves. And without an overarching big brother figure that can adequately police them or, like, you know, enforce rules, human nature by its nature, I believe, is evil, and they just degrade into a fucking monkey zoo. Look at a lot of prisons. They're gangs of just, like, freaking animals, and, like, the strongest gangs just, like, run the place in a very fucked up, fear-mongering way. Which, you know, in our evolution probably happened too, but it was probably very early on in our evolution. As time got on, the smart people kind of, you know, weaseled their way in. But in prison, they're reverting back to the olden times, and it's going to be a while before smart people take over, I think. But anyway, you know, a little rant about the prison system there. But yeah, El Salvador is kind of getting fucked, and it's not the only place that's getting fucked by the U.S. It's sad. But let's keep going.
The numbers that I have heard floated out coming out of this board are absurd.
Oh, this is disgusting. This one hits very close. The tenant speaks out as NYC rent board considers crazy 16% increase. 16%. Now, just remember, for an example, right? I work a job. I would say I work an average person's job. I make an average salary, if not a little above. Right? I make about $18.50 an hour. My pay increase was about 4% a year. And I don't think rent is increasing yearly. I think it's increasing, well, I don't know for this specific scenario, but even if it was only increasing once a year, 16%, I would have to work 4 straight years before I can afford to, like, catch up to make enough as I was before. And that's if I earned enough just in general to pay off rent in the beginning, which, you know, in New York, you definitely can't off $18.50. I think you need at least $23, if at all. Anyway, let's hear what this poor woman has to say.
They are cold-blooded. They are uncaring about people.
Oh my
while
God,
people
this is so sad.
Buy bigger and bigger yachts. Rent-stabilized
yep,
landlords make a great deal of profit. I know that to be true because the CEO of the Olnick organization who owns our property bought a beach house in Florida.
Oh, lovely.
Beach house. A third house with $7.8
million. Third house.
So they're not suffering. Meanwhile, tenants in Lenox Terrace are living in apartments owned by this landlord.
Actually, know where that is.
Who have the same asbestos tiles on the floor from when the buildings were built. The number.
This is disgusting. So, you know, for those of you who don't know, basically, I think the rent situation or just landlord like laws in general in New York are very, very bad. Or, see, it's hard to say like for who's it worse for, but I think the laws in New York are way more in favor of the tenant. However, what ends up happening, as with any government, is the rules and regulations get ignored so these landlords can do what they want. And if they can't, they lobby to do it. But a middle-sized landlord or a small landlord definitely cannot do it, and they're going to get blood dried too by the government. Someone is going to get money off of you somehow. They're going to bleed someone dry. And if you're not near the top, you're probably getting blood dry by someone else. But yeah, no, this is very sad, though. This is very sad. 16% rent increase when people can barely afford rent on an average salary. If the average person cannot afford rent, we're heading towards a very dark time, which, again, it's a shame we're not going to get to the solutions videos that I send myself, but, oh, man, they're good. They're good. And one of the things they say is that if enough people, if it gets bad enough and they realize, you know, how bad it is and how rich the rich people are, it's going to be an issue. And I always say, like, is it too late if, you know, people realize that? Because the rich are using technology and a lot of different means to remain in power, more so than they've ever had before. So even if people unite against them, can we even do anything anymore? Who knows? Anyway, let's go next.
I need you whiny.
Oh, my boy, Philip DeFranco. So this is one of the videos that we talked about in a previous episode, and I just brought it up here just to show the clip, I believe, because I think Philip DeFranco has the
little peasants to leave Pity City, please. Thank you. That is an only slightly paraphrased version of what this millionaire CEO said to her employees when they asked about their yearly bonuses.
Don't ask about what are we going to do if you don't get a bonus. Get the damn $26 million. Spend your time and your effort thinking about the $26 million we need and not thinking about what you're going to do if we don't get a bonus.
See, this is the thing I'm talking about. This is where, again, I said it before with the people who had $1 million in debt, and I'm going to say it for the very rich lady. Just based off the way she talks, she doesn't seem too smart in the sense of, like, she doesn't know how to talk to people to be liked. And she talks, and you can kind of tell that she's rich. She's entitled, and she's a prissy fucking bitch. This lady is the epitome of the greedy business owner. And I'm not trying to say that to paint business owners as evil. There's good business owners out there, but this is one of the greedy ones, and most of the rich people, if not all of them, are rich business owners that are greedy. That's not all of them, but if you're rich and greedy, you're probably a business owner, and this is one of them.
All right. Can I get some commitment for that? I would appreciate that. I had an old boss who said to me one time, you can visit Pity City, but you can't live there. So people, leave Pity City. Let's get it done.
Yeah, so this is where I think she's using negative reinforcement, right? She's basically saying like, okay, we didn't do as good of a job. Oh, you guys want money? You guys want a bonus? Now, I don't know how much they're making. I don't even know what line of work this is that this lady's like running. But, oh, you guys want a bonus? So, I'm going to assume they're the average American. Oh, you guys want a bonus so you can live, right? So you can buy food and not pay as you go, right? Well, too bad. Now that I haven't given you extra money, that you've come to expect, and it's going to be harder for you to live, now do better work. Do more and better work now that you're crunched. It's the opposite way of how I would do things. You should reward people, not punish them. Now, obviously, punishment is needed, but we're going to go in too far in too many directions if I keep going down these talking points. But basically, she's basically saying like, okay, I'm not giving you a bonus, now do better. Do better after I smack you in the face. Like, what?
Thank you. Have a great day.
Yup.
Oh, and that boom, why? But, this clip winds up online. It goes absolutely viral, and internet detectives dig up Owen's compensation package. With reportedly taking $5 million home last year, with around $3.9 million of that being in stock rewards and incentive-based compensation.
Whoa. So, I've said this before, and I'll just reiterate it again, because that's most of what I do in these episodes now. The internet is one of the best things to ever happen. If they ever censor the internet, if they ever, do what, I forgot what that stupid bill was called, but it was coming out, and basically it was a big deal in the gaming community for some reason. But it was this bill, that restricts the internet, and, you have to pay for, different tiers of service or whatever. Very weird. I think that was it. But basically, it was a restrictive bill towards the internet, and people shut it down. As long as the internet exists in the form that it does mostly currently, then it's really good at just disseminating information and making things more equal. Obviously, things are way far from equal, but the internet and guns are the two biggest things. They're the two biggest equalizers in all of human history, I would argue. You have no bigger equalizers in terms of what makes people on a level playing field than the internet and guns. Guns basically meant if you're bigger than me, I could still beat you. The internet says, you're doing things, now I can figure out what you're doing and why. It's crazy how good the internet needs to expose more people like this. And instead of canceling people for nonsense reasons like Sky Jackson does for some reason, we need to cancel these freaking people who are just greedy asswipes making people's lives worse and unlivable. Because, they're visiting Pity City. Fucking disgusting. Anyway, let's go next.
You know what's a wild...
Oh, we got my boy Dr. Huey Lee! I love Dr. Huey Lee. Again, he's going to be saying some old news here, but, we love Dr. Huey. Let's see what he has to hear.
This fantasy, right, let's hear what he has to say. International relations.
Bricks? What the fuck is that?
So, obviously, Dr. Huey Lee keeps saying, Russia, China, they're trying to devalue the dollar. They're trying to replace the dollar. And he gives a lot of evidence, and he gives the opinion. They're nowhere close to doing that. Even though this conflicts widely with the media's interpretation, which, as I always say, the media interprets things very biasedly for views and for negativity. But this is honestly where I don't know who's right, because I've heard from both sides, from the media and from, obviously, Dr. Huey Lee, conflicting opinions. But I honestly can't tell which one is right. I don't know. So let's see if Huey Lee can back up his claim with facts and or... convincing argument if he doesn't have facts and sources. Like the Credible Hulk. The Credible Hulk always cites his sources.
You can't just group five random countries and give them an acronym.
Yes, you can do better by
throwing darts at a goddamn map.
Okay, the BRICS geeks are that.
They will form a common currency to preempt US sanctions.
The yuan.
Okay, guys. Give me one reason that Brazil, India, and South Africa should worry about US sanctions. Is Brazil ready to invade Mexico? Or is India gonna invade, I don't know, Australia?
No.
Did you guys get some classified intel from that Minecraft server? Because nobody told me. Oh, you know what? I did see a headline yesterday about India having some security problems.
Oh, wait, with who? With China?
But guess who was on the other side? It was a C in BRICS. In case you don't remember, both...
it was the C. Yeah, Huey Lee is getting more and more funny as time goes on, but this is actually something that I'm very confused about, because even recently, I heard China and India were getting into spats. Like, I heard they were getting into issues, which to me is surprising, because those are the biggest, like, places on the earth, barring Russia. Like, when you think of just, like, big places, right, and I'm talking about population-wise, you think China, you think India, and then you probably also think of Russia. Those places just have a myriad of just people. Like, they have fucking just hordes and hordes of people. This is where if we ever got into a war with China, which, you know, in this dark dimension we might, but it probably won't kill us all, but who knows. I'm telling you, I've said this before too, the dark dimension curses, we'll get so close to ending it all, but we'll never truly die just so there can be people here to suffer. But anyway, excuse me. Whew. It's actually crazy how many people they have, where they have so many more people than us that if they went into a war with just people alone, they'd probably win. But that's where I think our technology trumps them. But who knows?
Both Russia and India actually had a war with China in the 60s.
Oh, but damn.
Guess who they never had a war with? The evil American Empire.
Okay, this is where he's making a joke. But as we saw before with the place down south, the U.S. is not fucking good. Like, he's saying it ironically, you know, U.S. evil empire. They really are evil, man. They really are evil. If you do not work within our interests, we get the big stick policy out. Our big stick policy now is sanctions, because we control almost everything.
So
or have a say in it.
You really think they're going to wake up one morning and be like, let's give China more control over our economy?
No.
If you want to print a currency, you first need a central bank to determine how much money you want to put in the economy. So these five wildly different countries would have to come up with a common central bank. If you think the CCP is going to let other countries decide the money supply in the Chinese economy, you don't know how the minds of control freaks work.
Yep.
Remember I told you about China's foreign exchange control? So what if some rich people start selling their yuan for some BRICS money, and then selling their BRICS money for some US dollars? Bye-bye capital control. I don't know about you, but I would do that if I had money. So let's see.
Which makes me question, his username is Dr. Huey Lee. Is he not a doctor?
The BRICS is not a military alliance for sure. And they have strict visa policies against each other, so there's no free flow of people. And they're not even a trade organization because there's no free trade between any pair of them. But hey, let's first get a common central bank. Let's get fucking married and then exchange numbers later.
Oh,
fucking base. By the way, I tried really hard to find any official statement about the BRICS currency. And none. It's all in your head.
Or not in our head, in the media who's trying to convince us it's in our head. So pretty crazy. I actually agree with his things. Obviously, he didn't support it with any, like, sources. But Dr. Huey Lee has not lost my confidence, so I'm not gonna cite him here. I'm not going to cite his sources here, of which he has none, but I'm not going to question him. Dr. Huey Lee, you've done it again. You've convinced me the media has lied, which is not a hard thing to do. Or not lied, but, you know, manipulated. Thank you, Dr. Huey Lee, for spreading some light in this dark dimension. Let's go next!
In about 6 weeks, the federal government will run out of money.
So, this was in May 1st. We are currently, I think, less than 10 days away. They said it's going to happen June 1st or before June 10th. They said the number's a little unknown. Now we're finally getting into the debt ceiling stuff, which is like, I've sent a lot of videos about the debt ceiling to myself. But basically, the debt ceiling, if it's not going to expire June 1st, within the first week or 2 weeks of June, it is guaranteed done. It is guaranteed we are defaulting if we cannot make a deal. Which again, we're in the final hour of that.
We won't be able to pay our bills. If that happens, we will go into default for the first time in our history.
Now, this is where it's cool to kind of see, like, this is the benefit of doing this so far later in the future. Well, not so far later, but like, you know, further out than like the time of when he's saying this, because we get to see how it plays out and what he thinks.
It would cause a major recession, millions of jobs would be lost, and it could trigger a global financial crisis.
Could? More like would.
That's what happens this summer if we don't fix this.
You know what's crazy? This is all from the United States being so central to the world and the world. Actually. And the United States did it to itself. This is what I don't understand, right? The United States is so entrenched in stuff. They affect not only themselves, but the world. And what do the Republicans decide to do? Oh, you guys won't, like, you know, do savage, like, budget cuts to us? You know, that you won't concede to us? Okay, we're going on vacation and we don't care. Like, you know, we're going to be fine. All the Republicans are going to be fine. The world is going to be fucked. America's going to be fucked. But we don't care.
There is a proposal that will let us pay our bills that passed out of the House last week. But it's dead on arrival in the Senate because it cut things like veterans' health care and law enforcement and education.
Okay, see, this is what I don't understand. Education cutting, even though I think education is shit, you know, you can sort of argue like, oh, because it's shit anyway, why are we putting so much money into it? Even though you could use the exact other argument, oh, because it's so shit, we should put more money into it. But regardless, right? Fuck them kids. So what else was they cutting? Let me hear this out.
It's dead on arrival in the Senate because it cut things like veterans' health care and law enforcement and education.
So education, I just went over. Law enforcement kind of makes sense because, like I said previously, you know, law enforcement is a very divisive topic right now. So we're not going to get back into that. But how the fuck are you going to cut veteran health care, the people that fought and protected this country? This is one thing that, like, again, I harped on prison for prison being bad and, like, fucking people up mentally that go there. Sometimes there's good people that go there and they get out and they, you know, they're different. They're not well, right? Because prisons are like a fucking zoo run by the inmates, not the fucking, you know, guards who are also probably corrupt. I think, personally, war is worse than that. And war really messes people up. Like, you know, you have shell shock, PTSD, a whole bunch of, like, mental issues, anger problems, drinking problems, you name it, right? If prison's bad, I think war is personally a little worse with what happens, because there you're encouraged to. In prison, obviously, it's against the rules and they can't go too far. In war, you're encouraged to go as far as you possibly can to kill the enemy. And it's really bad. So the fact that, like, you're taking away support for the people who, like, made, like, and, you know, keep up the country to what it is, which, you know, it's not good, like we've said, but it is what it is, right? I just find it baffling that they're, like, they want to take away from the veterans. A country should really take care of its people, which obviously it doesn't, but it should at least take care of the people who fight for it, which, at this point, it doesn't look like it wants to. It's crazy.
By the way, it almost didn't pass, but at the last second, George Santos ran out and cast the deciding vote. Pretty wild that it all came down to him. So now the Senate will come up with its proposal, which leads a lot of people to see this as a negotiation between Republicans and Democrats, and it kind of is, but there's a tougher negotiation behind that one. It's between Speaker McCarthy and his right flank.
This is something where I really appreciate Jeff Jackson for this, and, you know, I love showing him off on my platform of thousands of fans. He speaks truth. Not only does he speak truth, he's very personable. He, you know, it's a line of insight into our government where I feel like we have this with no one else. Jeff Jackson, if nothing else, seems very, like, you know, like, I can go to this guy and I could talk to him, right? Like, he's talking to me. It feels like I'm unique. Like, it's a one-on-one, which is very important to have with people. I learned that from media. But he does something very personable, and he also gives us insight on things that we like to know, that it's good to know. It builds a lot of trust. I would not be shocked if this guy actually ran for president one day, and with his current, like, you know, with his current track record, if no sick shit comes out, like he has skeletons in his closet or anything, I honestly think if he keeps up what he's doing, he has a really good shot at becoming president, if not from the electoral votes, because, you know, this country's all fucked with how they vote anyway, or how our voting system works. It's not by the people, it's by the electoral college, aka the smarter people. But I personally think he is going to have the popular, which is the vote by the people that does not matter, but we still count it anyway. I think many people are going to like this guy.
For the 30 or so hardline conservatives who are calling for
And I also forgot, he also shows you things that, like, you know, The media either twists and doesn't tell you, or no one tells you because he's actually a government insider. Think about this. You have a guy, right? A representative in our government on TikTok responding to people saying, you know, thanks, I'm not AI. Like, this seems so personal. It's insane. Another ray of light in the dark dimension. The rays of light so far are Jeff Jackson and Dr. Huey Lee. These two people are rays of light.
Biggest cunts. My sense is there could be plenty of deals on this between Republicans and Democrats, but the real sticking point is that there might not be a deal that lets McCarthy keep his job as Speaker.
So this is where he shows off some of the inside politics of what's happening that the media is not going to cover because either A, they don't know, or B, it doesn't sell. But it's like, I'm really grateful to Jeff Jackson because, again, he tells us the insider what I hope to be real news. I hope he's not bought out by, like, BlackRock or something and he's just spewing us lies, but who knows. But I trust him again. Like Huey Lee, he's done nothing to betray my trust yet.
Here's why. If his right flank isn't on board with a deal, that deal can still pass. We can find the votes without them, but they can retaliate. They can immediately turn around and punish McCarthy by calling a vote to end his speakership, and if they do, all it takes is five of them to vote against him, and he's done. And the thing about McCarthy is that he very much wants to remain speaker, which means a lot of what this boils down to is one man politics trying to keep his job. If he can't figure out a way to do that, then the odds of default go way up, because I genuinely don't know if he's willing to sacrifice his job as speaker to prevent default. And look, you may listen to me and have some stuff that you disagree with, and I respect that. I could be wrong about some stuff, but I'm not wrong in telling you that if we default, it takes every single problem that our country has and makes it worse.
Yeah.
It would be one of those decisions we immediately regretted. Clocks.
Not we regretted. Everyone regretted, voting for these Republicans.
Ticking. And I will keep you posted.
Or Democrats, depending on which side of the argument you're on. I don't want to single out just the Republicans, even though I personally believe they're probably the most at fault here. You know, I don't want to impart my views too heavily onto my glorious fan base. So, you know, it could be the Democrats too, just not wanting to budge. Because it honestly begs the question, and this is a good question, and I'm probably going to repeat this in the future episodes too, over the debt ceiling there, is the question of, who's right? You know, the Republicans basically are saying, like, we will not raise our debt limit because we're spending too wildly, inflation's going out of control. We need to cut spending in some places. Now, the places they're cutting spending, I think, are inhumane, personally, but it begs a good question. If you keep, like, increasing your credit card, right, you just keep borrowing and borrowing and borrowing, are you just going to continue that behavior, or are you going to, like, you know, wisen up and stop it? And also, these things that, you know, are proposed to get cuts, right? Do they deserve the cuts? Who knows? Are we paying too much into these things? Because, you know, me being in New York and me seeing Lewis Rossman's videos on YouTube, I've seen, you know, from his YouTube and firsthand, how useless the government is, both city and state and federal. Where they're given, you know, New York alone is giving, like, billions of dollars in budget every year, and they do nothing with it. Literally, and I've said this in the other episode too, the traffic light outside my job in the rich area of Midtown Manhattan has been broken for months, where you don't know when to walk across the crosswalk. You don't know basically when you can cross the street or not. You just have to assume or look at the other crossing lights and, you know, use, like, interpolation. And it's like, bro, this city makes how much from our, you know, how much of billions do they get, and they can't fix a traffic light in the richest part of Midtown? I can understand them not fixing it in the poor place, but the rich place? Like, come on. It's fucking crazy. It's just fucking crazy. But yeah, no, this would make everything worse, but the Republicans don't care. So anyway, nice of Mr. Jeff Jackson to tell us that. Let's go next.
Good morning, bad news. As of 2020...
Oh boy, back to good morning, bad news.
23, nearly everyone under the age of 40 is completely out of money. A new report shows that 3 out of 4 millennials and 3 out of 5...
Actually, let me read the statistic here.
40 is completely out.
73% of millennials are living paycheck to paycheck. Overall, 60% of Americans now say they're living paycheck to paycheck, according to a recent study. So they're not in debt yet. I guess 40% of Americans are in debt, which is still a big number using. But the fact that 60% of Americans are using all the money they make, if they lose their job, you know, that's insanely high. And I just don't know how these things can be allowed unless we were in the dark dimension.
out of money. A new report shows that 3 out of 4 millennials and 3 out of 5 Gen Zers are living paycheck to paycheck while saving almost nothing with no economic ability to buy a house or start a family.
Yeah, and then good luck for your future if you're not saving anything and putting into like an IRA or 401k or whatever. Your future is basically fucked. And even then, with the 401k or the IRA, you're still not guaranteed a good future because what if the economy defaults then and, you know, your retirements crash? Because your retirements are based on the stock market and the stock market reacts to the debt ceiling. So it's all these different factors that just go to show you, like, unless you're at the top of the top, you're still susceptible to all this fucking, and it's fucking disgusting.
Family or even cover a minor medical emergency. And that's because over the past 2 years, corporations have created hyperinflation on top of pandemic inflation through blatant price gouging to generate record-breaking profits, which are subsidized by historically low real wages, because since the Reagan administration, baby boomers have been leveraging their children's financial futures to make themselves extremely wealthy and create an economic system with the singular goal of increasing corporate profits at the expense of paying workers a living wage.
And also giving it to the So remember, I always say, if you can't beat them, join them. Become a shareholder. Get into stocks.
Ascending the possibility of middle-class mobility, which is why you can't afford a place to live, food to eat, gas in your car, or seeing a doctor, because if you were to have more money to improve your life, corporations couldn't use it for executive bonuses, stock buybacks, insider trading, or political lobbying. And they're the ones who get to decide what the extra money that you earned for them is spent on, and spoiler alert, it's not you!
When is it ever us? It's only them. Yeah, good morning, bad news, very divisive, I think very manipulative with very least the images they show. But it makes me question, like, you know, they are manipulative, but they do cite their sources. And if you cite your sources, you know, I haven't fact checked them, but I'm assuming they're real. And it's like, you know, you got to be at a certain level of integrity for that. So I'll always give them the respect with that.
Next. Is it time to defund Big Pharma?
So this lady before, we've seen her before, she's questioned, I believe, JP Morgan and Chase, the CEO, I believe his name is Jamie. Which is ironic because Jerome Powell is the Federal Reserve head. But, you know, Jamie, I think she questioned him of like, oh, how do you expect a full-time single mother working at Chase full-time to afford anything? And she did what I do, is she did the math and showed you the average rent, the average groceries, the average this, the average that. And she lowballed everything, which is, you know, like crazy to think of. And the Chase full-time worker was still going negative. And she even asked the CEO of Chase, Jamie, like, oh, you know, she's in the negative working full time for you. Your company can't provide enough for the average person to live in this country, right? Should she take out like a credit card line with you? Should she take out a debt using Chase? Is that good? And, you know, obviously Jamie couldn't answer and he played it very fucking sickly and slimy. He's like, oh, I don't know. I'd have to think about it. Oh, I don't know. I'd have to call her and discuss it with her. As if he's ever going to do that. The only reason he would do it now is because there's a spotlight on her. And he wants to, like, you know, get good boy brownie points. So he'll use her as, like, a little token example. But it's so stupid. But no, this lady's good, though. Before I, like, you know, go ranting and different. This lady is very, very good at what she does. Exposing asses.
CEO of AbbVie, which makes the cancer drug Imbruvica. Do you know what the annual price of Imbruvica was for a patient taking the standard 3 pills per day in 2013?
$130,000.
But Jesus. Today, for those same 3 pills,
it's $169,000.
We have $181,000, but we can agree that there was a significant increase. AbbVie itself didn't spend any money to create Imbruvica. It was invented by a smaller company, Pharmacyclics, which you later acquired, correct?
And look, perfect example of small to medium-sized, like, you know, I don't want to say mom and pop shops because they're making fucking drugs. Like, you know, small to medium-sized corporations and businesses just getting swallowed up by the giants. Like the fucking game of I.O. I forgot what it was called, but like the whole internet rave. Like, oh, you know, the big ball eats the smaller ball and gets bigger. That's basically what's happening with like the big corporations. They're just so big they can't fail unless they rip each other to shreds.
We paid $21 billion for the company, correct?
It was expensive to acquire them. Mr. Gonzalez, do people need less of this medicine, Imbruvica, to treat lymphoma now?
No.
Now, you told us that you spent $2.54 billion for Imbruvica, even though the drug didn't get any better. Really, it was all for these innovations and indications, which are designed to keep competitors off the market and find new sales opportunities.
So basically, it's advertising and crushing the competition. It's not improving the drug. It's making sure no one else can give the drug for cheaper.
So I want to look at what other money AbbVie spends doing its business. You filed 165 patents for Imbruvica. You filed patents for Humira, other drugs to keep competitors off the market. Mr. Gonzalez, how much did you spend, did AbbVie spend on litigation and settlements from 2013 to 2018?
Very specific question.
I don't have that number offhand. We'll be happy to give it to you.
Okay, $1.6 billion.
Like, I bet you all these people now really hate this woman. Like, all the big corporation people and owners, they probably hate this woman. And I wouldn't be surprised if, like, they send the hit out on her to, like, try and kill her. In a very, like, natural, oh, yeah, you know, she was unhealthy. She died of a heart attack.
$2.45 billion on R&D, $1.6 billion in litigation and settlements. What about marketing and advertising? How much does AbbVie spend on that?
Well, marketing and advertising, we spend about $4 billion a year.
Yep, he said that as if it's like chump change.
$1 billion. How about executive compensation, 2013 to 2018?
2013 to 2018, it's probably on average about $60 million a year.
Try 334 on for size.
Jesus Christ. She was like less than four times the amount. That's fucking crazy.
How much did AbbVie spend on stock buybacks and shareholders, stock buybacks and dividends to enrich your shareholders from 2013 to 2018?
Well, stock buybacks, if you actually look at just pure stock buybacks, it would be about $13 billion.
Stock buybacks and dividends is the question, sir.
Dividends.
You know, ironically enough, with a lot of the videos that I see, where it's like people debating or people arguing with each other, or questioning each other, aka arguing, in any sort of like official government space, it gets really ugly really fast. I'll commend the CEO of AbbVie here. He's being very respectful, and he's actually answering her questions straight up. You know, Katie Porter, she is a, you know, she's obviously a rabid dog. You know, she's going after them, she's biting them in the ass. But she's also being pretty respectful, too, honestly. At least to this guy.
With a number for that over that period of time.
$50 billion.
Bruh, when you remember, tell us that you can't beat them, join them.
Justifies those price increases. The big pharma fairy tale is one of groundbreaking R&D that justifies astronomical prices. But the pharma reality is that you spend most of your company's money making money for yourself and your shareholders.
Is it time to defund?
I mean, see, this is where, like, the argument comes in, like, okay, what is the company there for? They're there to provide a service, right? AbbVie provides a service. They, you know, help with cancer. But at the end of the day, they make money. What is the purpose of a business? To make money. So I don't necessarily disagree. I mean, obviously, you know, looking at the numbers, $50 billion or whatever, right, compared to everything else, you know, obviously they're going to lie. They're going to fudge it up. They'll be like, oh yeah, R&D to make the drug better, innovation. Meanwhile, nothing changed for it. It just got more expensive, which is evil and sick. But this is where, like, if you're an owner of the company, because the company's so big and it's a publicly traded company, a lot of people can quote unquote own it, even you and me, if we have enough money to buy one stock. But, you know, at that point, why shouldn't the owners of the company profit off its, you know, off the amount of money that they're making? I think they should. Now, obviously, it goes within limits, and, you know, it definitely depends on how much. Because I think $50 billion is a little excessive. But honestly, it depends. This is where I'm not fully on board. It's like, oh, you're a corporation, you're making money, you're paying yourselves, shame on you. See, that's where I think it should go back to the workers, right? I think it should still stay within the company. You know, they obviously shouldn't be doing charity work. Well, you know, they should, but they're not going to. Excuse me. But overall, I think it's better if they just pay their workers better, because then it's going to increase competition. People are going to want to work for them, which at that point, you know, they might monopolize and then they could do whatever they want. But let's not think too far ahead here. But anyway, good job for Miss Porter basically biting this guy in the ass. I very much like with Miss Porter. She is another light of hope in this dark dimension. Let's go next.
It was just announced overnight that a third major bank was just seized by the FDIC this morning.
And at the same time, the
FDIC
shit.
Has already sold it to JP Morgan Chase. Just hours ago, lovely. It was announced that First Republic
Bank. Hey, look, there's Jamie, the guy who Katie Porter also flamed.
Bank, whose assets at time of closure was $209.9 billion, is now the second largest bank failure in American history. It's not clear yet if this means, as President Biden said during the SVB takeover, if all senior leadership of First Republic will be terminated immediately as well. The Treasury Department is naturally on a public relations Nations pushed this morning to assure the American public that the U.S. banking system is strong. In a written statement, they went on to say that the banking system remains sound and resilient, and Americans should feel confident in the safety of their deposits and the ability of the banking system to fulfill its essential function of providing credit to businesses and families. This government intervention comes just days after First Republic reported losing roughly 40% of its deposits in the first quarter of this year. Amid rising interest rates and after the failures of Silicon Valley Bank and Signature.
Yeah, after the failures of all the banks being stupid and doing stupid things to increase inflation.
The bank earlier this year, a group of depositors also using the speed of Twitter began to move their money to banks where they felt safer with higher return.
And look, what is the thing that caused a lot of these bank failures now? The internet, the equalizer of information.
First Republic was most affected by the trend among the mid-sized banks. As of the middle of March, about 70% of its deposits were uninsured. Meaning they were larger than the FDIC's $250,000 guaranteed limit. That compares with a median 55% of uninsured deposits for medium-sized banks and the third highest level after SVB and Signature Bank. Despite a $30 billion infusion from 11 peer banks in mid-March, First Republic couldn't stop the bleeding. Its stock fell more than 75% over the past 30 days. I'll have more out as the day goes on, as this will undoubtedly create more panic in the banking system, possibly exposing more regional and mid-sized banks, leading to more potential takeovers soon.
And what does that mean? More potential takeovers soon? It means the rich getting richer because they're just getting picked up by the big corporations, aka JP Morgan Chase. But anyway, it's about 2 a.m. now. We've spent about an hour doing this, so it's not one of our longer-ish episodes because we've definitely gone for longer, but I would think this is long enough, and I might continue this later on tomorrow, but I don't mind stopping right here. Let's see how many we got through. We got through decent amount. I mean, you can see on the side here with the little scroll bar where we are. We're not too far at all, but we're farther than we were. So I hope everyone enjoyed this little mini, you know, mini quote-unquote episode of our TikTok reactions. I stream every day, or every night rather, at twitch.tv/technicschannel. You could come over there, you could come hang out, even though it's 2 a.m. I'm about to go there and stream right now, even though this is being uploaded way later. But, you know, come hang out, come see me there, and if you want to send me TikToks, add my main account, Tecnics, and send me any Dark Dimension shit you see there, and it might end up in here. But, yeah, I hope everyone enjoyed.